Okay. Well, first off, hi everybody, I'm Will. Thanks for coming. Beautiful day out. You guys be out enjoying the sun, so I appreciate you guys coming in and being present for this. So intro to GPU development for a Java developer. Is anybody doing anything with the GPU today? No? Perfect. Oh, yeah. Okay. What are you doing?
Well, indirectly, we have been using deep learning for Jade.
Oh, so you are?
Which runs better on some GPUs available.
Perfect. Okay. I was going to say, just playing Skyrim on your PC doesn't count as GPU development. Cool. All right. So, first off, just a little bit about myself. I've been doing Java development since 1995 on pre-release JDKs. I've been speaking at CJUG every year since 2004, and I actually started speaking here back in 2001. I've been doing software development in a whole variety of languages. Prior to that, I did some Pascal and C++ before Java. Dev tool work, last couple of decades, here in the Seattle area, clients locally, Washington State. And then I spent the last, 6 years from 2010 to 2016 as one of the co-founders of DevNod, which is a local consulting company that Emmerich just mentioned earlier. And so I was fortunate enough to be able to move on from that with my partner. We worked out a great arrangement. And so now I've been thinking about the last year or so to get a chance to explore some of my passions for things that I was interested in, which kind of segues to how I wound up giving this talk on GPU development. So when I was a little kid, so that's my son up there, and I look kind of like that, the glasses and everything. So you can imagine, 10 years old, I start programming on my Apple II, and I want to make video games. And that was kind of the gateway for me to becoming a software developer, right? Pascal games on the Mac, what have you. And so over the years, as working with Dev9 in particular, we did a lot of work with enterprises. And so I remember we were literally working on healthcare insurance software. And I'm like, how would I explain that to a 10-year-old that now I'm doing insurance software development? It was a great project, it was fun, but it's still not your passion. So last year I gave a talk on LibGDX, which is a Java game development framework. And that's when I started getting really interested in the GPU for development, because OpenGL and shaders and all of the game development technology is very different from traditional enterprise Java development work. So that kind of is the segue. So when it came time this year, I was talking with Nimret about what a good presentation would be. I said, well, it'd be really cool to take some of the stuff I've done with GPU development, and then more recently, some of the things I've been looking at related to data processing and execution with things like OpenCL, and I can give a presentation basically to you guys to save you a whole bunch of time. Instead of spending a year reading all those books, I can give you some of the highlights of that in a fairly quick period of time. So you guys get to cheat and jump ahead, not spend all that time. In line with that, one of the books that I found, most of the material that I went through, you can go through it online, I'll have you. There was a book on OpenCL. So this is the industry standard for compute language stuff, and this one's only available in print. There is a new version coming out. But since this one's only available in print, and I got a copy, I thought it might be fun to let you guys get a chance to browse it. So I'm just going to go ahead and take a look and just pass it down. And when it comes back at the end, don't run off with it. But Amazon, pretty expensive, so I got a copy. So just to kind of kick things off, talk a little about GPUs, I thought it'd be fun to play a brief video for you guys, just to sort of show the difference. So I'm sure you guys will recognize the speakers here.
Alright, I introduce to you Leonardo, and he's going to paint a picture for you guys in the way that a CPU might do, as a series of discrete actions performed sequentially, one after the other. And in 3, 2, 1. Gallons of air goes through these accumulators, out these valves, nothing's gonna paint the Mona Lisa.
The EU painting demonstration. In 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
So that was a promotional video that NVIDIA did at one of their developer conferences. And obviously, the MythBusters are awesome, and that's really cool. So before we go any further, what are the pros and cons of the paint robot that shot like a CPU versus the giant GPU? Like, if you're non-technical, you don't know anything about programming, what are the obvious pros and cons of those two devices? Anybody?
CPU can do different things,
right?
On what you tell it to do.
Yep.
Right?
Like fractional positioning.
Yeah.
Right?
GPU, you got to rearrange the whole setup.
Yep. Yeah, so if you wanted to change what image it's going to generate, you're kind of limited to that grid, change the paintball, but you can't, you know, do things in between, right? Anything else? That's the big one, right?
GPU's a lot faster.
Yeah, just a tad, right? Bam, done. Okay. Anything else? Before the main ones. Okay. So this is going to be the agenda of the material we're going to cover today. So a little bit of a brief history for GPUs. This is where I get to put on my old man hat and talk about things that happened in the mid-90s. Some of the uses today. Conceptual overview for how a GPU works and how you bid for it. We'll talk a little bit about the native APIs, because that is an important framework that you have to have before you can talk about the Java frameworks. We'll touch briefly on the local and cloud options, challenges, and strategies. So, make sense? All right, let's keep rolling. So first off, a disclaimer. This is a huge field, right? So it's not credible to say I'm gonna cover everything about GPU development. This is more like we're gonna browse through the table of contents, right? We're not gonna have a chance to go deep on stuff. The idea is that when you walk out of here, you're gonna have an idea of what other material you're gonna wanna look at, what other books you might wanna check, which of the pieces is going to be interesting to you for further study. And if you are experienced in this, because we're going to hit the high level, you know, a lot of folks might want to chime in with, oh, well, what about this or that? So I actually do want to hear that, and I want that to be part of the conversation. I'd love to hear, Eric, your thoughts on how you're liking deep learning for Java, right? But we'll just wait till the end. Okay, so brief history of computing in 5 minutes, whatever. So originally there were CISC CPUs, right? Anybody want, what's a CISC CPU? Standard complex instruction set. So that means that the machine language that the chip is executing has a fairly broad set of instructions that it's dealing with. Different alignments, the registers are pounding things in different spaces, it's more complex for how it's done. This is how the original chips were done. The PC version is an x86, and if you're a Mac version is a 68000. So those were some of the first 16-bit chips. So somebody got the idea, the problem with those first CISC chips was that they were integer only. Turns out that floating point would be emulated on those chips, which meant it was super, super slow. So what do? You come up with something called an FPU, which is a floating processor unit, a floating point unit, which added in additional instruction set capabilities for natively executing floating point math. So you might get a 50x performance boost when you're doing floating point math. So what are the things that you do with floating point math versus integer math? Integer math is great for things like a word processor. Floating point math is great for anything most notably involving 3D. Now, about that, shortly after that, you had RISC CPUs, which had a much smaller, reduced instruction set, but they also included native floating point. So, by way of example, I had code that I wrote in Pascal with some tuned assembly back way the hell back when that was targeting CISC-style CPUs, and I would write little hand bits of assembly to tune things up, make them run faster. With PowerPC chips, I threw it all out, and it ran 100 times faster. Just compiling it with Pascal code. Okay. So this brings us to more recently CISC chips, where it's a CISC instruction set, so it's compatible with all the stuff above, But if you actually look at the implementation under the cover, most of the modern CPUs are actually sort of have a RISC-like architecture. So if you take a contemporary modern Intel i7 chip, it's actually got its own little emulation layer that's taking in the old instruction set, emulating it, and then running it natively on something that, at least to me, looks like a RISC set. Cool, everybody good? And finally, so today, a modern PC for a gamer will typically have a Cisco's RISC chip and a GPU on it. So the GPU might be something that's embedded on the chipset. For example, this laptop here has technically has an embedded chipset GPU. And then you can also get, at the other end of the spectrum, something like an NVIDIA video card, which is what I have in my gaming PC to run my HTC dock. Okay, so, make sense? Okay, this is a broadly glass fast. What's part of the point here, right, is that if you think about it, like for this chunk of period here, you had to write special code or link in a special library to get be able to take advantage of the floating point. You didn't get it for free, right? Same thing's true with this GPU. You don't get it for free, right? Things have to be accelerated. There's different architectures between what's running here and what's running there. So we'll talk about that. All right. First consumer graphics card. So this is a Voodoo 2 card. There was a Voodoo card before that. You may remember 3DFX, a couple of these smiles and nods. It's a classic piece of hardware. Why did it come out? Who cares? All right, so this is one of the greatest role-playing games of all time, Final Fantasy VII, running on a PlayStation 1. It ran at a 320 by 240 resolution. You can probably see the pixels back there. See the pixels? Yep, cool. So you buy one of those fancy little 3D cards, and you can run Final Fantasy VII on your PC at 640 by 480, which is better than the original platform for PlayStation. Today, what would you call that? Right? People in the forums would say PC Master Race. You know, they're the ones that get to run the awesome stuff. This basically is what's still driving graphic cards today, right? That's what people buy them. You know, you buy a $1,500 PC, you put an $800 video card in it, just so that way you can tell your console friends that, you know, their graphics up, whatever. Right? So that's kind of what started that space. Now, the 3DFX card, right? Proprietary native APIs, okay? That everybody else wants to get into the 3D game too. If you're a chipset manufacturer, you want to sell these cool cards for hundreds of dollars, right? So that wound up spawning two uses for the GPUs, primarily, at least initially. So you had the 3D graphics, which is the first big one, right? And we're not going to go through all the history of all of the 3D graphics APIs, that's another whole talk. But the other thing that started to come up more recently, and this is more in the last few years, is also being able to do specialized execution for compute on that GPU, right? So if you buy an $800 graphics card, it's got this different set, and you want to use it for other things besides just using graphics, that starts getting really interesting. So let's talk a little bit about how this works. And this is probably the part where I start to get into the really confusing thing about, well, how does a GPU work, and what's its relationship to the CPU? So, from a high level, any of these apps that we want to run that take advantage of the GPU is going to have some sort of regular normal app, right? That could be as simple as a tiny little shell written in C, right? It could be a Java app, it could be Python, it could be whatever, right? Then that app is going to talk to the video card by basically sending over what are effectively little scripts. This is the part that was weird and we'll talk about later. But the relationship here is not that the CPU-based app is actually going to run itself over here on this video card. What happens is that you have scripts or code of some kind that get loaded up and then are sent over to the driver, compiled by the driver typically, and then run on the video card. So there are a couple of implications here. All right, before we go any further, name a 3D graphics API. Anybody? What are your favorites? What?
ATI?
OpenGL?
DirectX? CUDA?
CUDA, okay, that's another one, right? So there are dozens of these different languages that all run. And so what's happening is that these scripts are against these APIs, and then they get compiled and run by the drivers onto the video card. If you're like me, you might have wondered, why is a NVIDIA video card driver 500 megabytes? Or 380 or whatever. It seems excessive for a driver. right? I'm used to thinking of like a keyboard driver or a mouse driver. It's a K, not megabytes, right? So the reason is that those GPUs drivers are so huge is that they're effectively giant compiler sets that are supporting dozens and dozens of APIs, and then they generate microcode which gets executed on the GPU. Make sense? Cool. Okay. So, a couple other things that you might do with that. One, you've got data assets that you want to move over, right? So, if it's a video game, you're going to have lots of texture data. So, texture data might be, okay, I'm a 3D character. So, I've got blue here, you know, my pale skin here, whatever, my watch. I might also send over texture data for how bumpy things are, or I might, for how the reflectiveness is, or whatever effects I want to apply. Every one of those little bits of data is a texture data that I might send over as a large blob of data that I load into the driver to stick onto this video card. Okay, make sense? Any questions about this before we go on? Oh, last part. Data driver retrieval. So most of the time what I'm doing is I'm pumping in all this data, I'm sending over the scripts for what's supposed to be executed. It all happens in parallel and really fast on the GPU, and then there's a today there's going to be like an HDMI port or a display link or something like that that can then route data out to these. So there's a video buffer that this is all writing stuff to, and then that's what gets displayed on the screens. So in a video game, typically, the data's not coming back that much to the video from the video card. An exception might be if you're using physics on the video card processing, right? Then that might be sending some data back. But the magnitude of this might be today the you've got tens of gigabytes of video of data that are being managed, streamed at various points, loaded up, offloaded off the video card, depending on what's going on here. But you're not saying, hey, video card for a video game, give me back gigabytes of data that you're processing on the card. Okay, any question? Cool. All right, this is a more technical version of basically the video card, what's going on it. You'll note there is a compression unit that's mentioned up there, so modern video cards typically will compress the texture data. So as a side note, if I have 1024 by 1024 pixel data and it's uncompressed and I'm loading that into memory, that can be huge, which might be really sad if it's actually something that could get compressed down. Like I'm sure you guys have seen PNGs that go from the full uncompressed memory data to a tiny chunk of data. A lot of the graphics cards will compress the data in a linearly accessible format. It's easy. So they're doing that too. There's a video processor typically on these because you want to stream back real-time video. Just the sheer number of theoretical display ports that you might deal with on the graphics card is kind of impressive. Okay, now just to make clear how complicated these might be. This is a slide that is provided by NVIDIA describing the Pascal architecture for a GTX 1080 or 1070, which are the graphics cards that recently, because of Bitcoin, were going for like $2,000 and their list price was like $800 or whatever. So what we see up here are a bunch of cache, a gazillion processing units. This is raster. They've got a rastering engine there for how to process the data to go out to the screen. But the high level is that there's a ton of little CPUs basically going and processing this with a ton of fast memory. Now, they also offer a Tesla line, which is special NI. So at some point, it's more of an exercise in absurdism because I don't know that the slide tells you that much that's useful beyond using the little processing units. Okay. So how do you talk to one of these video cards? A little more detail on that. So there's the graphics and compute, there's proprietary vendor APIs, and then there's also open standard multi-platform APIs. So it's a little confusing. So here is a slide from a group called Chronos. And these are the guys that provide the bulk of what, as a Java developer, feels like the more natural headspace, which is cross-platform, open APIs, built by standards bodies that are then implemented by a lot of vendors. So one of the most famous of those, of course, is OpenGL, right? This is one of the oldest ones. And that this group was created to basically kill off things like that proprietary 3DFX video card, right? So the idea is, hey, we get a bunch of different vendors get together, they all agree to have this API. And of course, what that means is that you have an industry of video cards, and then the idea is that the developer who builds games can target OpenGL, and then the game will run flawlessly with absolutely no issues on every platform. Support, right? Right? Sort of? Maybe? Where have I heard this story before about right once, right anywhere? Anyway. So OpenGL's been around forever. It's gone through several version updates. I'm going to highlight a couple of the others here. OpenGLS is OpenGL for embedded systems, which the idea here was that this was going to be for beefy desktop machines, and this is going to be for mobile devices, because mobile started becoming a thing. So yes, was embedded. What that means in practice is that it turns out that OpenGL, because it came out much later, smaller API, but it supports most of the things that you actually care about as a developer. So you get into this interesting issue of full OpenGL, which now has become a very robust, complex thing for desktop class machines, which has tons of stuff in it. And then you have this OpenGL ES, which frankly does most of what most people care about. And this thing, this also happens to be the one that's on, say, your iPhone or your Android device, right? Yeah.
So, Will, I was just wondering, so, I mean, if you were actually a guy that worked for Microsoft from here, is DirectX a dead word now or something? Is
yep. That... We'll get to that. Actually, that next slide.
Okay.
Y'all are reading my mind.
Okay. So OpenGL ES then in turn became one of the, no pun intended, drivers for, okay, it is pun intended, for WebGL, right? Which is the idea is to take OpenGL ES and make it available for the web using Canvas. So now you can target a Canvas knockout in your browser. You can pass over stuff that looks like this OpenGL ES stuff and it'll run it from there. Two other highlights here. Vulkan is the new modern successor to OpenGL. And OpenCL is compute language. So remember how I said that there's 3D graphics? That's been classically the money maker. And then the idea was OpenCL was interesting initially for mostly enterprise and like scientific simulation things. So if you say, hey, I want to be able to simulate weather and I want to be able to run it on the graphics card. So for up until a few years ago on Bitcoin, that was more of the niche activity.
Will, is the OpenGL SC scientific computing? Is that the...
I'm not sure, honestly. I didn't have a chance to look into all of these. That's one of those opportunities for homework in this situation, I guess. I think it's worth pointing out that any one of these APIs to really delve into it could be a career. Right? So, you know, we'll talk about shaders and how you program these cards later, but, you know, just like, well, yeah, let's take a couple slides on it. So here are the native APIs for graphics that are the most popular, OpenGL, Vulkan, DirectX from Microsoft, and Metal from Apple. So we'll touch on this in a minute or two, but one of the challenges here is supporting all those APIs would be a bit of a headache, especially when we get into just how when you think about how complex they might be. Just to give you some of this is a slide on OpenGL versus Vulkan. There's a lot of terminology that's here that's very different, right? So OpenGL has renderers and different multiple memory types. So like that's much more noticeable, at least for me, when I'm looking at OpenCL, because they have like 5 different memory types that you're supposed to be able to allocate. Vulkan simplifies that. OpenGL came from the older versions, which were called fixed pipeline, where it was a very set way in how you're supposed to process the graphics. And there's still some legacy for that there. Remember how we talked about the shader languages being embedded in here and then shipping the shader source? So with OpenGL, that is actually one of the nice things is that you can actually go in and look at your games and pop them open and you can decrypt them. You can just see the shaders and like that. So now you have 2 very large APIs that now are completely divergent, right? And this is just OpenGL and Vulkan, Metal and DirectX. And DirectX itself has also gone through many, many changes around version 12 now. It's a lot to deal with the managing process. So let's dork down for a sec. So I mentioned OpenGLS for mobile, and it's not 3D3D. So let's take a moment to just kind of look at this. So I'm going to open up the Wi-Fi was working. This cool website called Shader Toy. So this is basically not drawing on the screen. So this is a really cool site. What Shader Toy is it's basically a WebGL shader playground site. So you can go up here and find something cool. So, yeah, okay, this is pretty awesome, trippy, right? We're all gonna go to the light laser show after this, it'd be awesome. Cool, so what you see over here is you see this is the actual shader script that's generating that image. And we can scroll through and look at it. Now, a couple of things. So, main image, this here is basically the main method for this little simple code. I can't zoom in on this one too well, too much, maybe. Yeah, it's perfect. Okay, so this is the script. So what you see here is you see it's got a output fragment and an input. And so it's dropping in a vector form. And then from there, it's all the processing, right? So everybody can follow this exactly, right? You guys can tell. This is the problem with all the shaders, is that they're basically little bits of math in a script that's not terribly large. And what's interesting is, this is all the code that's being generated, and you may look at it and say things like, well, what the heck is high resolution Y coming from, right? So these are little static variables that are being injected by the shader language itself, effectively. And as part of this Shader Toy site, they've effectively created their own little API to inject additional values. So one of the things that we can tell is that it's got a time concept as this thing's rotating through, right? And here in their how, they describe some of the pieces that are coming in. So I can see I've got my output, my input, pixel coordinates. They actually have the ability to generate sound as well, so you can get crazy stuff like that. And then they have just added, this is pretty recent, VR shaders. And in shader language, they're called uniforms, which are the variables that are injecting the data. So, what in the heck are we even looking at here, right? So we have a shader script, which is this little C looking file, right? And we have values that are getting injected into it from the host environment. Right? Make sense? So, and they've got a weird terminology, they're calling them uniforms. There's a couple other terms that they'll see. But basically, this is the binding between your host code and whatever's coming in here. Make sense? So let's say that you've got your mouse. Okay, so the mouse. Right. Let's say every frame that you're doing graphics, and every frame that you're doing the graphics, you want to inject in the current position for the mouse. So what you might do in your host code, which is the code that you're writing, so it could be in C or Python or Java, you're taking that code, you're fetching that mouse frame, and then you're then updating that value and sending that into the graphics card. So you're basically creating code that's binding between this script here and your native code. Basically make sense? Okay, so observation. Now, Shader Toy is awesome because people put up all of these cool little weird scripts, right? Let's see if we can find another one. Oh, here we go, water. So here's a script that's generating some killer water. We can scroll through it, we can see this here, right? You know, what's going on. But is this the kind of code that you're going to want to write all the time? And do you write it? And how do you? There's some other really weird questions, like how do you test it? So we'll pop in to look at some libgdx shader implementations in a minute to see how the Java world kind of interacts with this stuff in a minute. But just something to kind of think about. For time, I'm not going to. Okay, so there's another site called Construct. That's a game development tool that's written entirely in HTML5. You can bop over to that, and you can use that to play around with WebGL and a whole bunch of different effects and shader effects and things like that, while also interacting with the video game. And it's really cool because you can have these crazy effects, like you might have a bloom effect, or you might have a ripple effect, from Inception or somewhere, The Matrix or something, where there's like a little water drop ripple effect that's really complicated. But that's actually coming from an HTML5 game. So the way that they're able to do that by having WebGL render that effect using a shader against the little chunk of browser canvas. Which is a side note, is part of why browsers are now becoming insane, because the newer versions of CSS all add in 3D effect capabilities, which are also leveraging the ability to use that WebGL. So you might be saying, hey, that could get crazy. There's like a million APIs for doing graphics. And how in the heck do I deal with all that? Because they all have different implementations. So if I've got DirectX on an Xbox, and I've got PC OpenGL, how do I manage all this stuff? And this is where tools like Unity and game engines come in, right? So this is the background is the Unity 3D's target list of all the different platforms. So everything from an Apple TV to, I think they didn't finally drop BlackBerry, but you can see everything from Xbox One to Nintendo Switch to whatever up here on this list, right? This shows one of the limitations. Yeah.
Is that the same technology Netflix uses to stream their movies?
So Netflix is streaming things with a video player, right? And Netflix has the money that they can build a native video player for every platform that then takes and processes the native video that they send across. And that's part of another one of the challenges. So if I'm using a game engine like Unity, so Unity 3D is like, I'll just say it's the most popular game engine on the planet. That's, you can argue about that after beers afterwards, but it's used by millions of developers. So that's a game engine. It has a video player in it, and so that might be helpful. But if I'm Netflix, I'm just going to build a native app that targets every one of those. Netflix has the money that they can build a native video player for everything. They don't have to worry about the game engine. They'll just hire an engine or something like that. Which is a strategy for if you said, hey, we are building a AAA game. We want to be super awesome. We're going to do our own support for native API, graphics APIs you can. So, but generally speaking, most folks are, once they look at that list, they're going to say, hey, I don't want to deal with things at that low-level graphics level. So most developers are not going to implement things using Metal or DirectX or whatever natively in 2018. Because you won't be able to make money. So LibGDX targets the ones primarily on their website, the ones that are highlighted, and then they also have I call it work in progress because you can kind of get to work, but then you're into the kind of grimy world of somebody wrote a blog post once, maybe that showed you how to get config to work kind of stuff. So it's there. And the common denominator is that those are the easiest ones to support with OpenGL. Next up is native APIs for compute. So just the same way that I take the graphic shaders and I can load the graphic shader into the driver, I can do the same thing with compute. There are two main APIs, one is OpenCL and one is CUDA. I'm mostly going to talk about OpenCL because I come from Java for a long time and I'm interested in open standards. But CUDA is very popular right now. And there's a couple of the tools that don't support OpenCL right now. So that leads you to an awkward situation where you have a Java library that only works with CUDA. We'll go back to that. So, how do we work with CUDA? Okay, so this is the main for a CUDA app. So if I write something in C, and we're gonna look at an example in just a minute. I'm querying to ask what all the devices are, select them, create a command queue, buffers, transfer the data, I create this thing. Cool thing, it's a kernel program object. What to me, when you see this, this is like a shader for coding. Thing, but it's basically this is the actual code that you want to run on the graphics card. Okay. So you can either, with these, you can either compile it, or there are now options where you basically offline compile the script, and then that's the thing that's loaded. But the thing, what they're calling a pre-compiled binary, I probably would call more of like an IR, an intermediate representation, a little bit like a Java bytecode format, but it's a completely different format. Because this is the intent there is for things where you have a little bit of perf, or because you don't want to go down your scale code. You create the object, you config it, and then you tell it to run, and then you pull the stuff back out. So, this is coming from GitHub, so I'm going to show you really quick some of the source for what this might work like. Here's the C++ file, which again, you can't see because we're on the screen. So all that stuff I just did.
Okay. Before you're typing your password in.
Yeah, no, I was just, I'm a dork, so I'm navigating to my files in terminal, not finder, whatever. Anyway, so this is the C program that shows the OpenCL setup. So here, you can kind of follow what's going on because it's well commented. So it's basically saying which OpenCL platform are you going to target, create the GPU context, and then from there, there's the command queue that it was talking about. So that's how I'm going to be sending in the commands, right? I send in the commands to allocate memory for it, pull the data back out, and then here's the create the OpenCL from the kernel source. Fine. And this is kind of the important thing here, because all of what we're seeing here in this C application is just the bureaucracy to get the app to run, right? We're not doing anything on the graphics card or things. We're saying, hello, graphics card, are you there? Hey, allocate some memory for me and all that. No, I'm actually running the code. So if we go over here, right next to it, we see this .cl file, which Xcode from the format. So that's pretty impressive, right? This is the actual code that's running on the GPU. And so basically, much like the shader, you can see it's declaring some values that are coming in, and then it's passing the result back. So probably all it's really doing is just adding a couple of numbers to actually send you that. Yeah. Right. So what's going on there is it's using the global ID that it's fetching from a static for memory allocation. So the presumption is there it's fed in a bunch of memory allocation, and then it's looking at memory values and then slamming them together and then passing the results back. So clearly, you want to use a GPU for all your addition, right? That's basically all this is doing. But it's illustrating how much bureaucracy work there is to creating these kernels and then running them on the GPU. You guys following this so far? Is it what you were expecting? The GPU development? Right? Like, just for the starters, hey, I'm taking these little scripts and I'm actually compiling them on the video card or with the driver. Like, it's a very weird development environment experience in a lot of ways, I think. So, let's take a look at so here's another app, Convolution. Okay, what the heck is this? So this is a very sort of more real example of a small, simple thing that one might do on a video card. So I'm taking in data, or I've got this input signal mask that I'm basically applying. So what's going on here is I'm basically saying, hey, I want to apply this vector transformation to all the image data that's coming. Again, we can scroll through this, and this is classic C code. right? And I'm passing in, or I've got similar things that I'm doing to allocate for the devices, input the output, and then I'm applying a mask. So I'm just scrolling through here because the point of this is an intro, not to walk through the code. And again, what we can see here is that the actual script that's getting run on this is pretty tiny, right? So this is the .cl script, which is the code that's actually getting sent to run on the computer. There's not a lot there, right? We're just trying to minimize it, get stuff in, and pop it out. One thing that you may notice when you look at this, there's no if statements. So that's a big bugaboo, is that as soon as you start writing if statements, what happens is the GPU gets put into a mode where it's got to deal with contention issues in a different way. So if you're a normal Java developer, how often do you use an if statement? Right? So it's much more, in a weird way, it is more efficient to do something like pass in texture data. Yeah.
How come there's still a for loop where I thought GPUs don't like for loops? To do everything in the
exactly. And that's, I think, you're touching on it, which is that it's really easy to write something badly in the burden, right? So this is hello world demo code, right? So yeah, it's doing effectively if statements inside the for loops, right? It's still got your branch. So yeah, it's going to kill it, right? This is hello world code, effectively, right? For a simple demo example, you know, probably not going to do it, but is it good for oil, and are you getting the perfect one out of it? Because you can write those things, right? But they don't say, like, you can't write if statements. They just simply say, hey, you're going to screw up the processing speed. And that is part of the problem with GPU development, from my perspective, which is that it's incredibly easy to shoot yourself in the foot by miswriting a kernel, right? So I was using a metaphor earlier, and I'll touch on this. You're kind of jumping ahead a little bit, but I hit forward. Like, if you guys have ever worked with a tool like Hibernate, it's really easy when you start playing around with Hibernate, and you're like, hey, I'm just going to grab a bunch of collections and fetch things and whatever, to then blow everything up, right? Because you inadvertently do an n plus 1 times n plus 1 query, and that's the way you blow half the database in the memory. So then you wind up sort of backing off and saying, well, I'm not going to do that as much, right?
Graphics card died.
What's that?
Well, that jail time.
I know. There's no power. Power's there. Can't bridge them. And this is kind of jumping ahead a little bit, but part of the point on these is that these kernels, which are the actual code that you're going to run on the GPU, you're going to want to keep them tight. You're going to want to be really on top of them. You're going to want to perf check them. You're going to want to make sure that they're doing what you think. Because one line of code blow the whole thing up effectively. You can just kill her. Yeah.
So Will, just trying to get some bearings here. So you're interpreting all this with CUDA, right, or something, or what's the library? If you open a graphics driver, right, it looks like assembler. They're putting stuff in registers on the GPU,
trying
to render graphics. You're not doing any of that here.
No, this is basic. This is so. This over here is a C-based application written in C, right? But this could be written in anything. It actually doesn't really matter. The guy that wrote the book picked C, because C is what's been popular for graphics programming since the dawn of time and whatever. This could be libgdx. Not for OpenCL, but for OpenGL. It could be libgdx, it could be a Java-based thing, it could be Python. So if you use, was it PyTorch, I think is the AI framework for Python, right? So if I use PyTorch and which is Python, but I use GPU acceleration, it's the same kind of thing. There's some Python code that's wrapping whatever it is that it's then going to send over. And this is the script that actually getting sent to the graphics card to run. So the graphics card driver is compiling and executing this over on the GPU.
Are you saying it's really a transpiler?
I won't get into the terminology of the transpiler.
You can compile that and that.
No.
No.
No. This is just the C code. If we look down at the source file, yeah, here, it's right here. it literally streams in the source file. Right? So I've got my C code, it hits this point, and it streams in the source file. And then it's going to then copy it, creates it with the source. And then what it does is it actually is going to take that code. So basically it's saying, create a program with the source. It's actually taking that source file. And the way it works is that it takes the source file, it loads that, it sends that source file over to the graphics driver. The graphics driver compiles that and then passes back a reference to that on that code living on the graphics driver.
So is that without OpenCL and not with OpenCL?
No, this is all OpenCL. This is the native, this is the host app. So this is the thing that's running on the CPU. Okay. So, right? And this is the code that's being run on the GPU. So this loads, this is the host app on the CPU, which runs, loads the source file, and then it just takes the driver, effectively, passes this file, and it sends it.
You have to not like that program.
Well, who wrote this and who wrote that? No, I mean, well, developers are involved in all of this. You know, hey, this is the stuff I have my admin, right? Like, it doesn't really work out. It's just the different languages. This is a language that's defined by the OpenCL specification. It's inspired by C, but it's not. It's its own special language, right?
Maybe not in this matchup, but it could be CUDA or it could be any one of the other languages as well.
Well, this gets into the core issue about platforms and interop, right?
Right.
So if this was written in CUDA, it would look differently because it's a different language, right? Different semantics, it's very different.
But you have a similar setup where you have the startup code and then you have the GPU code,
right,
which you ship over to the GPU card.
Absolutely. Now here's the kit, right? If I bought an AMD card, can I run this?
Yes.
Sure, right? AMD, yeah. So if I buy an AMD card and it supports OpenCL, then I can send this file over and it'll run, right? Just like ANSI SQL or something, right? Like I should be able to run it on any of the platforms you're supporting. If I write this script over here in CUDA, right, it's only going to run on an NVIDIA video card. So who wins in that scenario? NVIDIA, right? Because now you have to buy a ton of NVIDIA. A bunch of people have decided to do that. NVIDIA is doing very well, right? Because it becomes a whole, ecosystem just like any of the others. Yeah.
I guess, how unique are these CL files? Are there libraries that you can leverage, or is everything kind of like, oh, I have to write my own script because I'm doing something so unique?
Dude, again, you're stealing from later in the
okay,
day.
Sorry.
Yeah. Well, I know, because right, like if you're me and you're looking at this and you're like, screw that, I'm not going to do that, right? But I like the idea of things running fast. And so then you get into this interesting problem of, well, what are you trying to do, right? So, which kind of segues into some of the stuff for the rest of the presentation that we're going to get into today, which is, what's my strategy for dealing with this? Because, yeah, like, it's weird, you write one line wrong, and now you're just going to screw up the branching, which then blows up some of the threading and the GPU. You know, your worst case scenario is you go buy one of these expensive GPUs, your shader does something stupid, or your OpenCL or whatever, or your CUDA code, and the next thing you know, like, the whole thing's running, you know, it's just doing stuff in synchronous with your CPU, but then it's like you just threw a whole bunch of money in there, right? Okay. So, what are some of my developer frameworks? Okay, for graphics, Java OpenGL, LibGDX, JMonkey, these are some of the Java-based frameworks that take the OpenGL, and so JOGL is basically pretty close to just Java-based wrappers for OpenGL. So if you think back to the C-like API of, remember all the command buffer stuff that you have to set up in OpenCL? Something kind of like that in OpenGL. And yours, like, the end of the day, you're a developer, you're like, I just want a graphics card and I can send graphics to it. It's cool, I don't want to do memory buffer allocation and all that stuff. JLGL is just the thin wrapper on the same original C API, which is cool for them because that also means it's easier to maintain the API, because they're mechanically generating off of header files, Java implementations. Other frameworks like OpenGX, they will leverage one of those that OpenGL implementation or the Android OpenGL implementation for running their code. So libgdx, which I'll tell in a second, is a Java-based game framework. So I don't know if you guys came to the presentation I did a year ago. I think the video is up if you want to check it out. So it's a game engine. You can do 2D games and 3D games. And it has high-level Java primitives to deal with all of the normal things that you want to do. So if you say, hey, I want to take a texture, a PNG off my disk, and I want to load it onto the video card, and I want to add a spin in 3D and do a bunch of cool stuff, you write all that in high-level Java primitives, or high-level Java, but you know, it's an O thing, it feels like Java development, it's cool. So you may say, well, then how does the shader stuff work? So if we go into libgdx itself, and again, you'll see that they do have some JNI code in here for accessing various native things. Go to graphics. Yeah, so you see when, as I'm navigating through, it's all just Java source files, but then they also have thrown in two of the shaders. So there's fragment shaders and vertex shaders. Vertex shaders get to tweak things on geometry, and vertex gets to change things on pixels. So if we looked at the Java code for this, what we would find in there is a line of code that literally is loading this file. So this is the shader file that's being loaded by libgdx and sent over. Kind of remember the kernels for OpenCL, the shaders for 3D. So this is the shader file for libgdx is 2D, I believe. No, it could be 3D. And it's one of the things you'll notice is that it's got a ton of ifdefs. So those get passed in as arguments to the script by libgdx based on the settings that the user's choosing. So it will say, hey, different levels of precision. You can see it, are you using specular textures, blending things? So it's kind of like C, but it's also got a million ifdefs for what you want to do. Support shadows, lighting, and then here's the main method. So at the most basic level, it says, hey, whatever the pixel is that came in, that's the pixel that we should start with, which is the RGB value. And then it also will do processing based on whatever you ask for. So for example, if there is a blending texture that's being passed in, then go ahead and do all this. Otherwise, just go ahead and use an alpha 1 for a solid object. So libgdx, when you use it, you might fire up multiple shaders, pass them in, and then you can have different shaders being applied to different texture JVET as part of the processing. So nobody wants to write shaders for a living, right? If I go to like the game development show in San Francisco, there's like sessions of people and all they do is write these shaders for a living. So when someone says, hey, how do I do this stuff for shader effects, I would say there's a ton of off-the-shelf resources. There are books that you can buy that are literally nothing but shader books. Or you might want to go up on a freelance site and say, hey, dude, I want a cool effect that does blah, can you do it for me? Okay? That's if I'm a Java developer and I don't want to go down. But all the game engines all come with all that shader stuff. So remember how I showed the Unity slide before? And they have like DirectX and Vulkan and Metal and all the other APIs. They're basically providing implementations of all this stuff for all the video cards and all the APIs. This is why libgdx doesn't natively work on some platforms. Because they've got the OpenGL shaders, but they don't have any DirectX stuff, for example. So that's why you're never going to see a libgdx game running on an Xbox.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So now we're going to take a look at stuff from the graphic stuff, and everybody's here for the dollar for Bitcoin, right? That's why you guys showed up? You're all Bitcoin miners in your spare time? So you might be saying, hey, I want to do Java Bitcoin mining, and then when they get rich, at least until Monday, and then Tuesday, who knows what's going to happen, right? So this one's thin, and I think this is interesting. There's a library for doing Bitcoin management, so you can do Java to say, hey, I want to do Bitcoin wallet manipulation. There is an OpenCL implementation of a Java-based Bitcoin miner that's been abandoned, and they just say, like, just use a standard native one. Okay, more compute. Deep learning for Jack. So this is probably, if you're here because you're interested in machine learning and AI and neural net stuff and all that, this is probably what you're gonna wanna look at. So, Eric, you sound like you've been using it for a while, so you probably can talk to him more than I can. But what it is it's a Java-based sort of framework for this, and it has a whole set of components for ingesting it, transforming it, processing it, a lot of things that, to be perfectly honest with you, I haven't gotten to do yet. One of the things it does, what's interesting is that you can use native GPUs for processing of certain things, but it's based on CUDA, not OpenCL. And so, if I had told you guys that something was based on CUDA but not OpenCL at the beginning of the presentation, hopefully now you understand a little bit more about what that is. In addition, you've got multi-GPU with Spark processing. So IBM has done presentations where they're showing Spark implementations with native GPU processing for things like image classification. And I think this part starts to, much like graphics or something else, it starts to get into the question of what are you trying to do, right? So if your goal is I want to do data processing of some kind, certain things will be accelerated by running on the GPU. So image classification is a good example of something like that. If I'm trying to pick out things, is there a question? I'm trying to pick things out of a graphic where it's worth bothering to load the graphic into the GPU and have a kernel process that then goes through and process that data and then get something out of it, then it's worth doing. But now we get this real complexity of like, well, now I'm trying to figure out whether or not my algorithm is going to benefit from running on the GPU. I have to be able to figure that out. Okay. So, so all I'm doing is dabbing into the So here's a convolution example. So what this is doing here is this is a little sample bit of code. And you can look in the resources directory and see a bunch of images of animals. And so it's basically the code that's then going to process animal classification. And what we'll see here is it's loading the data, and then it's going through, it does have a native image loader, and then trains, processes, and this is all AI and ML stuff, not graphics. Right? So effectively what somebody's done is they've already gone in and they've built the little OpenCL, or in this case CUDA programs, that then take little chunks of the code and deep in the guts of it, it's got modules that are then dropping stuff off for GPU acceleration. same thing, as far as I know, is true with all the other AI frameworks. Is that what people are doing is they're going in and they're writing little chunks of code that become these kernels that then get knocked over onto the GPUs and then process things. So, to me, at least, this feels like I'm reading a DSL for doing the training. It's not Java code, but it's like up higher and doing things that it's doing. So, if you're like me, and you are looking at deep learning for J, and you look at the docs for all the things that it does, and it's got it for the GPU support, the proper human response is to feel overwhelmed, because there's so much stuff that one could do hypothetically, right? And if this is getting into more career stuff, I guess, it's not, I don't believe, possible to know all of these domains. So you're gonna have to pick things, either for personal interest or professional, for why you're gonna want to tunnel a little of this stuff. Okay. Now this, so you're like, hey, this is cool, at least I want to play with it, maybe run some of the examples, whatever, how am I going to run it? So then we're like, whether 20 minutes, 15, 20?
No.
Okay. Right. So how am I going to run this stuff? Well, it turns out this is kind of a problem because OpenCL is the standards framework. People in the know sometimes complain about the OpenGL and OpenCL support native on the Mac is not as good as the Windows version because that's when it gets more TLC. My experience has been the Mac version, at least for OpenGL, is fine. I'm not pushing the limits of trying to do strange particle effects or what have you. But the problem is that NVIDIA video cards like the Pascal series and the Tesla and all that kind of stuff do not currently work on the Mac unless you are. Well, I will click on this link, and you can see this is what it takes to get NVIDIA and CUDA working on the Mac. So you have to unlock your bootloader, I believe. You have to enable it to work specifically. You have to turn off the system integrity protection. It's a hell of a thing. It's not something that is for the faint of heart. It's basically what I'm trying to say. And it's certainly not supported by Apple. If you call out Apple and you said my machine got hosed because I was doing this stuff, they're gonna laugh. The other one is the NVIDIA product line, and I'm not going to bother bouncing out to the page. It's huge right now. NVIDIA knows that people are trying to do very specialized things with their video cards, and so then they have this very complex array of offerings that target different uses and scenarios. So you may be saying, hey, I'm not sure if I want to go buy a $2,000 AI-specific card or something like that to play around with it. What I would suggest is looking at something like AWS, yeah.
Can you take off the NVIDIA chip and put something else on there in the Mac, or is it only operable with an NVIDIA card?
So this is the problem with these ecosystems, right? So Mac laptops and desktops like the iMac, if they do have a video card at all, it's from AMD. And AMD is locked in the fight to the death with NVIDIA. So if I run CUDA, which is made by NVIDIA, it only supports NVIDIA cards, but all the Macs ship with AMD cards. And so you can't pop the AMD chip off the card, off the thing. This laptop here is a MacBook Pro 13-inch. Everything in that machine is just glued on. So you can't swap it. You can't change memory. You can't change hard drive. You can't. And changing a graphics card is like, that would happen. Yeah.
Is there such a thing as like a virtual machine for graphics cards, obviously, for performance, but like for development?
Yeah, so VMware, I can speak personally to VMware Fusion. VMware Fusion has has 3D acceleration pass-throughs for DirectX and OpenGL in the VM, so you can actually get some stuff to work. But it's running through another interpretation layer. So like, if you're running an old game, it's fine. So like, I think if it was running something like Civ 4 or 5, maybe, right? Like, that would be fine. But if you're trying to run like a contemporary 3D FPS, like, I wouldn't try to run like a new version of Doom like that, because then you're going to run into an interpolation. I think if your purpose is, hey, I want to run OpenCL processing fast and try to talk to the video card for that, I don't think that would get you anywhere. Which is part of why I put this up. So this is AWS's prices on getting super fast, or it's AWS's configs on machines. So you can get a PC instance that's got 8 Tesla video cards, 128 gig of GPU memory, 488 gigabytes of normal memory, and you can just spool that up for an hour.
I left the ramen for a weekend once. I was on the move.
I had to flee the country to fill up my VM running. Yeah. Yeah, and they don't let you access these with the free hours they give you either. You do have to pay for them. So this is part of that whole conversation about if you're doing architecture work and you're trying to figure out where things are supposed to run, it's like, you know, you're trying to figure out in advance, well, where should I put this processing and what's the advantage? For example, let's say that my task is I'm trying to classify, you know, a million 64 pixel square JPEGs. I'm trying to run classification on that. Is it better to get a couple of instances of this and use GPU accelerated Spark, or to just use regular Spark without the GPU on more normal size and then maybe a larger cluster? Which really, I have no idea, right? But that's the problem, is that like, unless I ran the test, I would never know. I'd have to conduct an experiment if I know. Yeah.
So why can't you piggyback? You know, you got GPU on top of Spark on top of...
We do, right? So like, if I use one of if I use Deep Learning for J, right? Then the cool part is I just flip like one thing in the Maven POM file and say, yeah, I want to include the GPU support, right? But here's one of the problems is if I flip that on and then I delegate the work to the GPU, but let's say I'm running it on normal servers that at best case have the world's cheapest integrated graphics chips, well, now I'm now copying that data over the buffer a whole lot, over the PCI bus or whatever. I don't know what the bus is for that, just a local system bus. Copying that data all over, and if they're tiny little JPEGs, then I'm opening and shuttling data over those handles and filing them in those buffers. Is that going to buy me ahead of where I was or not? I don't know.
AMDAL's lot.
What's that?
AMDAL's lot. At some point, you're going to...
Yeah, yeah. There will be tipping points. And the answer that might be correct for... processing 1,000 images versus 10 million images, you're going to have different criteria. But what it means to me is that effectively as an architect, the takeaway is now I have to account for things like what is the processing cost on all these different cloud environments? Do I have a framework in place to perf and understand what I'm doing? Now here's another complicating factor, which is that just AWS alone offers a ton of off-the-shelf, higher-level machine learning services. So if my goal is to do machine learning or image recognition, and AWS gives me a high level tools for that that are higher level than I just talked to via REST service. So I say, I don't know, maybe I upload, you know, a terabyte of video data by putting it on a USB stick and using the AWS thing that lets you do that, and then I throw it up on AWS and then I run this thing and I'm not writing anything like the kind of code I'm writing otherwise, I have to deal with managing Spark instances or Kubernetes or any of that stuff. Is that a better solution or not? And maybe you say, hey, but these are proprietary APIs, but I have a job that I'm running. Okay? So I run the job. Maybe I only need to process my terabyte of video once, right? It's just complicated. Right? here's the GPU support from Google. So Tesla V100s are $2.50 an hour. And if it's a sustained use, it's $1.73. That's for like a $3,000 machine or a $3,000 card right there. So, and of course they also offer their own AI ML services as well. So you can take a week just to read through all of them. I'm sure Oracle's got it all. It's got all sorts of too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. And they're all fighting with each other to get the price down, right? So, yeah. Okay, so a couple of challenges on the, this is more on the ML and the AI side, is you can't, is it's hard to predict the performance. If you are writing your own kernels, like I said before, you can blow up the performance, and it's hard to test it. So let's say that you make a tweak to the to a kernel that you wrote, and then you're now pushing that out, and you have a desktop machine that has a 1080, because you're shoehorning your gaming machine to do some OpenCL code. Cool, maybe it works fine, and then you go push it out to a Tesla machine, and there's something about the concurrency of what your kernel is, and then you blow up stuff. Run the same, so challenging. So a couple of tips. So this is my my tips for people who want to go down the path of implementing this stuff. If you're doing shader effects, what I would strongly recommend is to not do the I'm just trying to hack it together with code to make it look like what I want look like first. So you're not going to do, I wouldn't recommend doing shaders first to try to implement. Like, I don't know if you've ever done this, like, you basically will write little chunks of HTML to mock up your UI, for example. Right? You know that? If you do that with the shaders, you're just going to go crazy. So what I would say is try to figure out the visual effects that you're trying to accomplish and track how you're building them very carefully in something like Photoshop or Motion, and then treat it as I'm trying to implement those specific things in the code, in the visuals that I'm trying to achieve. Make sense? For the compute, think of those kernels as those little nuggets that you want to do. Build them, get really clear about what they do, and then lock them in so that they run well and they're tested so you're not going to visit them all the time. Especially if you have money, just hire a specialist unless you're really passionate about wanting to explore that for some reason. A bit about the data movement is that blow up what you're doing if you're just moving too much data back and forth off the bus anyways. So that. Last little bits of tips here. So if you are interested in AI and ML, so I have a bunch of friends that are basically like, hey, company X wants to throw a ton of money at me if I can learn how to do AI or ML. What I would suggest is, before you do that, go ahead and grab some books and statistics, run up on those, and get really clear about what those are first, and then start doing the AI and ML stuff. Couple last little bits here. Okay, so there exist tools for a few other uses that I did find that do hit the GPU. For example, this is AES, which is a solution that in bulk. There's a Java SDK that wraps a GPU implementation, so if that's your specific domain model that you're dealing with. And that one appears to be OpenCL because it works on AMD with the cards. And we have a little bit of time so I can talk about Rootbeer and Project Sumatra and JVM on the GPU. So there exists a project up on GitHub. And what it is an attempt to port over using Java, the language, to write the shader language code. So that is basically a transpiler. Is that a good idea or not? Should I be able to write those OpenCL scripts, like you saw those little chunks of code, the chunks of the fragment, not the fragment shader, the actual OpenCL things that were those little kernels? Is it a good idea or not to be able to write that in Java as opposed to OpenCL's native C language?
You'd have to have the JVM run all the time, right? Which is costly, right? You'd have to.
If it's just transpiling. It's weird.
Yeah,
because you're not going to get the JV. You're not going to get all the logic. Well, what you will get is the syntax. You're not going to get the API. So when you think about the JDK, right, Java's naming is very confusing because it means the language, the VM, whatever, right? So what you get with something like that is you're going to get like language semantics, and you're going to get a little bit of calling things. But remember, it's transpiling back to that native language underneath, effectively, right? And so this is why I'm not convinced this is a great idea, because now you're taking something that is this little weird scripting thing that you're supposed to be running OpenCL code on, now you're writing it in Java to get what benefit?
That didn't work out a lot, like all the time, so they tried to make Java generate JavaScript.
Right, Java generating JavaScript.
It always is just horrible, actually.
Right, because you actually wind up having to know both.
Yeah.
At a level of proficiency that's actually a lot higher, right? So,
and it seems you would want to reduce the allowable constructs for like Java Micro or something like that, where you know you can't do all these things because they just won't translate.
Yep.
Into
no SOAP web service calls.
Yeah. SOAP for the GPU. Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah. It's cool that you mentioned the JTME stuff. It's really, hey, it's Java, and then you like start working with you, and you're like, oh my god. Okay, last couple of things. Okay, so this is the last bit. This is my food for further thought. So this is a screen cap of the NVIDIA site for where they're going and the uses that they have for it. So we talked a lot about deep learning, game development, so they have special SDKs and things to help out with that. One of the things, oh, this is actually a good point. The GPU, so if you think about the scripts, let's take an OpenCL script, and I write a kernel, or I'm writing a shader, and then that gets compiled by the driver into the, whatever the target code is that gets executed on the GPU. The implications of that is that that means you can't debug or do perf work of anything running on that GPU without proprietary vendor tools. So remember those little OpenCL scripts or shaders? That's an extra giant problem, because now you have to deal with the perf and the tuning issues, right? So you just say, hey, well, why'd my script blow up? I don't know, right? By default, all you get from OpenCL is if a script fails to compile, it'll report back errors, which you have to then capture manually and standard out. So when you see something like NVIDIA talking about their game development tools, one of the things that you're going to want to get pulled down is something that could then let you instrument and get proof data out of what's going on there. So you might say, hey, I have tons of memory. I should be going ahead and doing the processing to throw stuff up, but the processors on the GPU are getting flooded. So here's some of the ones that, like, to me is like, oh, okay, I don't know, as individual developer hacking at home, what you're going to do with autonomous vehicles. If anybody starts hacking on their car, cool, smart cities. You know, future is coming.
I'm working on a better Minneapolis.
Better Minneapolis? That's just setting up for Minneapolis jokes, right? It's just a straight line. Okay, so we covered a lot of material. Q&A session now. I have some more slides that I threw in for more back pocket stuff. You guys want to click through that real quick? Okay. There's also a deep learning Databricks implementation which has GPU. There is a TensorFlow Java implementation of GPU. There is a wrapper for CUDA available. It's a Java-based implementation that you can play around with. Abrapi is another implementation of a JVM on the GPU card. And then I mentioned Sumatra already. We talked about that. IBM has an implementation that is also trying to do GPU dev. Talked about that. Cloud. Oh, Java 10. So the short news is that the only thing that's really relevant for Dev in Java 10 is local type inference. So he's not type info on a local variable. There's a ton of other minor API changes and tweaks and things. As a side note, deep learning for J has a dependency on Lombok, which Lombok has brought up. Lombok is currently blown up on Java 10, so you might just want to give that at least a month or two to pick that patch for its LDStream or LDStream. Then my last brain twister. So remember that slide at the beginning when I showed like CISC and RISC and the GPUs and stuff like that? So as part of it, as I was poking around, it's like, well, what's the future, man? Qubit computing. So IBM currently offers a qubit computer that you can program in the cloud. So this is supposed to be a UI that's hooked up to a real cloud-based qubit. And what you do is you drag, you can click over there to set up gates that you can then run on here to be able to execute, and you can do quantum qubit collapse for things in the cloud. So to me, this is like the next step in like, I'm not sure what I would do with it. It's kind of interesting to play around with. But if you thought that doing massively parallel execution on a GPU was cool, you can always play with this and you can see the future there. I'm sure Warp is doing that, right? I don't want to.
No comment. No
comment. Okay. No comment. That's worse. Only for defense. Only for the DoD, right? Okay. Covered a lot of material. Q&A. Any questions? Eric's here working with deep learning for JS, so maybe if you have questions about that, maybe we'll help out. Yeah.
Developers haven't really had to deal with the details of CPUs for a very long time. Why is the GPU world such a comparative nightmare?
Well, I would make a case that, this is part of like a very long trend of computing around parallel execution. And you know, the old 68,000 chip, that, like I used for, or the 86, like the old IBM one. It was just single threaded, right? Like, you get to cheat, even if it's not really, because people have like TSR. Like, we could just sort of pretend, feed instructions in, and stuff happens, right? And to me, I don't think that computer science as a field has really addressed how to deal with parallel execution well, because of the abstraction problems. So, like, I'll give you an example of a bad version of that. So, the JDK introduced streams, native streams, right? And they have in there the ability to do parallel thread execution on the stream. I can create streams. I can say, hey, I want to execute this arrow. The problem is that the API doesn't expose anything about whatever the hell this is going on or the ability to moderate it or manage it. The attitude is like, oh, the JDK would be smart to do it for you. Well, but the problem is now it's kind of leaky and weird. It doesn't work right. So you can use native, you can use a whole variety of different currency systems that are built into the JDK. You don't try to do that. It's just nothing but handguns aimed at your foot laying everywhere, right? And I don't know that there's a good answer for parallel execution that just sort of happens. So like with the JVM, you can kind of pretend, especially if you're doing something like Spring Web Services, right? You can kind of pretend, like, I just don't use statics. Cool, right? Like, each little request happens on its own little thread, right? Not good, right? Like with GPU dev, it's all about multiprocessing. And there's no way around it, right? Like, take a ton of data, want to, just like that machine at the beginning, right? It's like, you know, I want to take that 1,000 pipes and I want them to all go blammo at the same time, right? And there's no way that I know of that you do that and then can't expose at least some of the problems around the type of the data access. So like on the GPU side, with the graphics API side, that kind of mostly have said, hey, well, what you do is you load these big data textures in, and then you write your shader, and the shader just is getting fed like one pixel at a time. So the more pixel renderers you have, the more you can do. Bam, done, right? The data, like, there's a slide I didn't put in, but it shows like the five different networks locations that you explicitly can load the data into. They all have different rules for concurrency, like what you access when. It's crazy, and I don't know that there is a way to simplify it too much. Like, you can go to a certain point, that's where like anything having those little tiny atomic kernels get executed, but they're very carefully written, and then your operations, that's why they do it that way.
Do you think that working with multiple cores of the CPU and working with the GPU, that those are dramatically different problems?
Yes. So the question is, are multiple threads on a CPU different from multiple from GPU?
No, a CPU with multiple cores, it's like a whole bunch of different CPUs.
Yeah. So this is the challenge that the CPU people have, which is that they're still effectively emulating old like Syscape APIs. And so they do all of these crazy things to try to get around the fact that as devs, they're kind of cheating and still just beating up single threaded looking things, right? So are you familiar with blanking on the name, to the big chip vulnerability?
Spectre,
yeah. So the way those vulnerabilities work is that the CPU, in order to try to be able to get ahead of its single-threaded code, it's looking at all the code that's coming down and it's trying to do a prediction on where to go. So what they do is the microcode on the chip is effectively jitting a whole bunch of different paths that the code might take in an attempt to increase the parallel execution. And the heart of the bug is that code effectively, when it's jitted, I can write on this, right, Nimrod?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's say this is a very, very vague high level thing. So I have my code, it's a bunch of instructions, and you guys can see that. There you go. So think of these as like a series of instructions that the path might go down, right? And this is like just raw assembly, for example, right? Okay, raw binary instructions, that's the one here. So with and there might be a branch option here. So it might say, hey, it might go down here. I might go down this set of instructions, or I might branch and go down that set of instructions. But the CPU doesn't know which branch it's going to take. So it loads up both, and then as it's incrementing through, it says, hey, I'm going to take this chunk of CISC instructions, pre-compile them to a set of internal RISC instructions, right? So it makes its own version of this, a binary version of this, and it has this binary version here. That's almost like Heisenberg's cat. The CPU doesn't know which path it's going to go down yet because it hasn't gotten to the data execution, because there's something happening with the core, right? Here's the thing that's really bad, is that it turns out that if you assemble the instruction set right, you can actually perturb or read data even though it doesn't actually get executed. So you might say, that sounds terrible, right? And the answer is yes. And only it's worse because the stuff that is jitted actually executes at a different privilege level. So the actual code may not be able to access the data, but the code that was jitted but never accessed is able to then access something else that wasn't supposed to read something. So, right, it's cool. It's like the ability to take advantage of that, like to me, is like it's assembler hacker insanity, because you're basically handcrafting assembly to inject in to perturb how the CPU's microcode is being compiled and executed. So I'm like, dude, the guy that comes up with this stuff, I mean, that's freaking unbelievable, right? But, yeah.
Whatever happened to quantum computing? Was it bad or?
So quantum computing.
Is it just that hype?
So quantum computing is. You don't. Are you sure? Quantum computing is basically the idea that you use aspects of the way that quantum mechanics works to entangle things and then have things collapse in at the quantum level, right? And the idea is that you can actually process things in advance. It's very confusing to explain, just because quantum physics is very confusing. But the idea is that you set up the conditions correctly, and then you can then say, hey, I'm going to look at the whole thing, and the whole quantum resolution collapses at the same, the right way, and then you get the answer to your problem. So where quantum computing became really scary is that the basis for all of our encryption is factoring numbers. Right? So you take big prime numbers, multiply them together. It's easy to multiply them together, hard to break them apart. Factoring products, right? Yeah? Did you want
to? Oh, no.
I'll finish those.
No, go
that's
ahead.
Totally wrong.
No.
I've been working with the NSA for years now. That's the way it really works. So the problem is that in theory, a quantum computer could break all of our encryption that we use for everything that we do, like our banking, every time you use a browser that's in an encrypted mode, you could just instantly factor the prime, which means that you instantly can get the keys to every encrypted transaction that ever happened. So the US government, among others, was reputed, rumored to be working on Google is supposed to have built one. There's a private company whose name I'm blanking on that has a quantum computer. But the quantum computers themselves, to program them, you have to be a physicist who understands quantum computing and be able to understand all those pieces together. So that thing I was showing you at the end with the IBM cloud-based quantum computing thing, it's kind of a joke because, I mean, maybe my son's smart, but I don't think he's 10, right? Or he's an executive. He's 8. He's not like going to teach himself to do that like I was teaching myself to do my Apple computer back when I was a kid. Quantum computing is its own thing. As a side note, if it makes people sleep better, there are new algorithms that are being introduced that are not vulnerable to a quantum computer's attacks for encryption. If that makes anybody feel better. There are other algorithms that are now being introduced for highly secure environments that don't do that. And that said, everybody's browsers, at least the standard browser stuff that you're doing, as far as I know right now today, if it is true that the NSA has a quantum computer, which if they do have one, it's probably incredibly expensive and hard to maintain, but in theory they could probably.
They got the money.
You know, what else?
I mean, they exist since their birth, but they're at this point they're still slower than a conventional computer. So.
Well, for certain things. That's the part that's totally ridiculous, is that if you have certain calculations that you're trying to do, then I think that a 20-qubit computer probably would be better.
But the buzzword is quantum supremacy, and so once someone can show that like you can calculate something that would be unfeasible with a conventional computer, we're not quite there yet. Or if someone figures it out, they probably won't tell anyone.
Right.
Well, that's the NSA is requesting new algorithms that support quantum computing, and they are available right now. NSA started last year making requests for new encryption algorithms.
But they haven't been rolling this out.
No, it's a competition.
Yeah.
It will last a couple of years, but you know they are working right now along those lines.
Yeah. Well, it's like all of crypto. It's just this crazy arms race. It's pure math. You throw in the quantum physics stuff that you need to figure out. It's cool. I spent a couple of weeks learning to be able to put 1 + 1 = 2 on a qubit, and then like whatever. Anything else?
So does every machine which has an NVIDIA card come with CUDA installed? And is it easy then to install deep learning for Jane? So
deep learning for Jane to install it and get up and running with it. You know how to set up a Java project in Maven. You can pull down the Hello World apps and start building stuff.
So then it will talk to CUDA and
then GPU? Yeah, so the NVIDIA driver, that's why it's so big. It's like 300 to 500 megabytes. One of the reasons why the NVIDIA driver is so big is that it's effectively a complete compiler and dev chain for a ton of APIs. So it's got its NVIDIA driver, it will have CUDA. So I'm assuming Windows, right? So it's an NVIDIA driver on Windows. It's going to have CUDA, it's going to have OpenGL, OpenCL, DirectX, with probably 5 different versions of DirectX, probably backwards to that. I'll have at least 2 or 3 levels of OpenGL to pad. I'll have OpenGL GLES support, I believe, unless they just fall, unless they're just considering the open GL. But no, I've been running open GLES stuff with OpenGX on the system. And that's ostensibly ES. So, like, yeah, I mean, it's, that's why it's so big. It's almost like you're putting a development environment on it with a driver. Yeah, so there, so you got Windows PC at home and an NVIDIA card. You can pull down deep learning for J, several computer examples. Docs are on ARM now, are really good. I would say that before you can do anything, that you kind of be able to have a solid solid handle on the stats side too. Okay.
You don't need the NVIDIA card by default. It has a, just a native driver that just runs.
Oh yeah, yeah. Sorry,
but,
yeah.
But you can easily swap with a CUDA. Implementation.
Right, so yeah,
which good luck finding an AWS instance that has a compatible version of CUDA to run.
Right, right. So you can use deep learning for J without an NVIDIA card. So if you're like a Mac laptop and you just want to hack on it and play with it for fun, and you're doing things like the Hello World, like the example, that image, that animal classifier example, it's only working with a set of like 100 images or something. So it's tiny, and you can do that on your laptop. But, and this is where, like, you know, the terminology gets weird. It's like when you're doing, you know, big data-like things on tiny little data sets, but it's in the name of learning. So, yeah, they work fine. I would just say don't bother trying to, if you have a Mac, don't try to use the NVIDIA video card to go to your Mac. Just keep it as the rest. And I think we're about wrapped up. One last question.
How does an NVIDIA chip card differentiate from an Intel chip card?
I will answer that one after. So Intel has its own set of graphics cards, but they're much, much weaker than an NVIDIA card.
Inferior?
Yes. Inferior. I don't want harsh on too bad, but like they're just different usages. So an Intel integrated chipset that they're going to sell for really cheap, it'll come on like a Surface laptop. It'll work, but it's not like going to be awesome for playing games. Because all you're doing is using Windows. Okay? But those same Intel chipsets are going to support all these bunch of these APIs. That's good. All right. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.